Good morning, guys. This is Miriam and Ryan. Even though it is kind of a difficult time, we feel like it is very important to keep on worshiping God. And you don't have to do it necessarily in singing. It could be in whatever you do. So Ryan and I are just going to be playing three songs for you guys. And hopefully you guys enjoy.
Yeah.
thank you for this day, Lord. Thank you for the opportunity to be able to do worship, Lord, over the technology, Lord. I pray for the rest of the day that you just bless it. And Lord, I pray for the study that you would have your hand upon us all, Lord, that we would understand what you're trying to tell us, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Bye, guys.
Good morning, everybody, and happy Palm Sunday. Welcome to the Children's Ministry. Hope you kids are doing well and you guys are hanging out away from the rain. And since we're home, we're going to go ahead and continue studying online here until they lift the ban and we can gather as a church again. So until then, I hope you can track with us. We would normally be going through the Old Testament. We would be teaching Jacob and Esau, but today, because it's Palm Sunday, I thought it'd be appropriate that we would actually talk about Jesus coming into Jerusalem. So let's go ahead and let's come before the Lord in prayer. Lord, we come to you in Jesus' name. Father, we just pray, Lord, that you would just speak to our hearts regarding this passage that is set before us. Lord, just a chapter rich with prophecy, things that you have spoken of in the past and what you intend to do in the person of Jesus. And so, Lord, we just want to lift up this time. Speak to our hearts. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as I said earlier, we are going through John chapter 12. We see Jesus. He's been in Bethany. The crowds are around him. And as he comes to Bethany, in the previous chapter, I want to give you a little backstory here before I go too far ahead of myself. In John 11, we know there's a family there in Bethany that follows Jesus. They're in love with Jesus, and they've been following for quite some time. But Lazarus had become sick. And Martha and Mary, his sisters, they send messages to Jesus that their brother is sick. You need to come and heal him. So they're waiting, and this sickness is unto death. Well, he ends up dying. Jesus comes to Bethany, and he's been dead 4 days. Now, if you've read the scripture, you know by this time they're getting closer to the Passover, and there's just a multitude of people following Jesus. You have his disciples, his inner circle, but you have people who are following him because all the things he's doing. And as he gets to Bethany, as again you look at Jesus' life, as if there's anybody dead, they don't stay dead for long. So Jesus brings Lazarus back to life. And now it takes us to John chapter 12. And here we find Jesus coming back to Bethany. He had left and he's returned. He's back at Bethany. And then they make him a huge supper. And so you have to imagine, homes weren't very large at that time. So the place is packed out. It tells us that Lazarus is there at the table, and there's a ton of people. Well, it tells us also that in the next day, we know Jesus is going to begin his entrance into Jerusalem. So I want to go ahead and also let you know that as he goes into Jerusalem, this Passover week, Jerusalem is getting flooded with people, with Jews traveling from all over the ancient world. People from North Africa, Spain, Rome, for example. And they're starting to stream into the city. People have heard all the things about Jesus, what he's done, how he's healed the blind, how the people who are deaf are beginning to hear. People who have physical disabilities are now normal again. They're hearing about Lazarus, how he's bringing people back from the dead. And so you can imagine in the minds of the people how curious they are. Who is this Jesus? And is he really the Messiah? People are talking about that. And here we are. We're in Bethany. And again, imagine the picture here. It is the day, the following day is what they would call the 10th of Nisan. When you say, what's so significant about that? Well, the 10th of Nisan was significant because the Passover meal or the feast is, again, a few days away. And they have to present a sacrificial lamb. And you know it couldn't have been any lamb. That lamb had to be inspected. It couldn't have, you know, a blind eye, a short leg, or missing any body parts, or any spots or blemishes. It had to be a good lamb. So the priest would examine the lamb. Well, a tenth of Nisan was the day that you would present your lamb to the priest, and they would inspect it. Now, a Jewish family, you would present one lamb, not one lamb per person, but usually a lamb per family. So the following day was the day where you would present your lamb. So imagine that's what's going on right before he goes into the city. People are going to bring their lambs. Again, to me, that's a significant picture, because Jesus is going to enter in Jerusalem and he's going to present himself as the Lamb of God. So let's look at verse 12 of chapter 12 here. It says, the next day, a great multitude that had come to the feast, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him and cried out, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel. So we see here, the people are rejoicing at his arrival into the city. The people took down palm branches and they went out to meet him. So you can imagine these people are excited. They have these palm branches and they're running from all over the place and they're there to greet him. And what does it say? They cry out, Hosanna, Hosanna highest. What does that mean? What does Hosanna mean? Hosanna means save now, save now. Loosely translated, save us now. And why are they saying this? Well, because the Bible tells us in the Old Testament, remember there's no New Testament at this point, they're anticipating the Messiah to come. And the scripture tells us that the people who would see the Messiah come would respond this way, to save now, save now. But now you have to also imagine, we live in a free country. We don't know what it's like to be really oppressed. Well, they had the Roman Empire, which was really oppressing the Jewish people. And so in their minds, they're thinking Messiah is going to free us from the heavy hand of the Romans. They want to be free. So they're saying, they're crying out, save now, save now. But what the scripture really intends for us and for them to know was Jesus did not just come to save them from a Roman oppression. He really came to save us from our sins. That was his goal. That was his mission. He came to this planet to save man from being lost, from and being separated from God. That's really the intent of really why we should sing Hosanna, save now. So they misunderstood this, that Jesus came to save them from their sins. And my question to you today is, how do you see Jesus? Do you see him just as a religious figure? Is that what he is to you? Do you see him as a good guy who teaches good things? Or is he your savior? Is he your Messiah? Has he saved you from your sins? And hopefully he has. If not, we'll touch on that in a little bit, but you should be able, you should call out to the Lord wherever you're at. You know, maybe this bothers you. Maybe this, you're like, you know, I heard this before, and Jesus isn't your savior. Hopefully by the time I'm done, the Lord would just convict your heart, that you would surrender yourself to the Lord, because we're all lost and we all need a Messiah, and that's why he came. His purpose in life, the reason he came, was to save you and to save me. And notice in verse 14, it says here, then Jesus, when he had found a young donkey, sat on it, and as it is written, fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt. So here Jesus is actually demonstrating he is a king. He finds a young donkey to ride on. Now, again, some of you may be thinking here, why a donkey? You know, why couldn't it have been a horse? Something a little bit more majestic, something more kingly, right? Well, in that day, it was customary for kings, when you would see them on a horse, it was usually in battle. Some war was taking place, they would ride a horse. But whenever the king wanted to present himself to the people, let's say in a parade, he would come riding on a donkey. An act of humility, as you can imagine. Well, here this donkey, it gives us, this actually the scripture gives a description of this donkey. He's on a young donkey. Okay, what's really significant about a young donkey? Well, the other gospels tell us that this donkey had never been ridden on before. So could you imagine when there's an animal that's never been ridden on before, he's going to fight you. He's going to buck you, because he's not used to that. He's not accustomed to a person sitting on them. So here's Jesus, finds a young donkey, and he rides this young donkey. And again, indicative of a king coming into Jerusalem. And it really speaks to me because even creation recognizes its creator. This donkey recognizes its creator. And to me, it's a beautiful picture that's kind of put before us here. And then here in verse 15, it tells us, again, this verse, that Jesus was fulfilling prophecy written about him in Zechariah 9:9. What is prophecy? Well, prophecy in the Old Testament was God was giving the people glimpses of the future, just like a movie trailer. When you go see a movie of a movie that's going to come out in 6 months, they give you a couple of seconds of scenes of what the movie is going to look like, right? Getting you excited to, so when the movie comes, you want to go see the movie. Well, Jesus, in the same way, actually the scripture, the same way, gives us glimpses of the Messiah. And Zechariah 9:9 foretold exactly the picture, the image of Jesus riding into Jerusalem. It foretold that. So Jesus is actually fulfilling prophecy as he rides in to Jerusalem, riding a donkey, as the scripture has said. And I want to share kind of a side note here. The cross-reference of this passage in the other gospels, Matthew 21. So if you go to Matthew 1, you're going to see a similar story here. And in Matthew 21, the beautiful picture for me is what's going on is he's riding in Jerusalem. The people are waving the palm branches. They're excited. And there's a word there in Matthew 21, I think it's verse 7, where it says the whole city is moved. Say, so, okay, they're moved. Are they moved emotionally? No. Again, understand the picture. One historian, Josephus specifically, who lived at that time, tells us that there was probably over 2 million people in this city at that time, visiting, not that lived there, visiting. Usually Jerusalem had about 100,000 people at that time. So you can imagine a small, how can I put it? Imagine the Rose Bowl, okay? If you've ever been to the Rose Bowl. And imagine that there's a bunch of buildings inside the Rose Bowl. Imagine 2 million people kind of going through the streets in an area just a little bit bigger than the Rose Bowl. The place is packed out with people. And so you can imagine when Jesus is coming and riding into Jerusalem, there are hundreds of thousands of people. There's, I mean, a myriad of people behind him. He had Mary, Martha, Lazarus, Simon the leper. He had people that he had touched and healed. They're all riding behind him, and they're just crowded around him. And it says he's riding in Jerusalem, and the city is moved. And that word for moved is the word for earthquake. The city was physically moving as Jesus was coming in to Jerusalem. And I could just imagine what that must have been like. Here's Jesus. He's coming in. We also call this his triumphal entry, right? He's coming. He is the King of Israel. Hosanna, save now. And the place is moving. And you know, I really begin to think about what that must have been like. Because a week later, he was going to be crucified. He is going to be placed on a Roman cross. They're going to really tear him apart. They're going to beat him. As I say, Isaiah tells us, he is going to be marred more than any man. He is unrecognizable. As a matter of fact, there's a portion there in Isaiah where that Jesus is looking down from the cross. And he says he could see his bones from the side of his body. He is beaten so bad. And I'm not going to go into that description, because it is a terrible way to die. But there's also another triumphal entry coming in the future. When Jesus conquers the armies of the world in the book of Revelation, and he's going to ride into Jerusalem, and the people are going to be waving palm branches. So there's another one coming. We can be part of that one. And if you don't know Jesus, hopefully today you'll come to know him. You can come to him and you say, well, how do I pray? How do I accept him? Well, the way you accept him is first you acknowledge you're a sinner. You know, there's a lot of people don't realize they're lost. I didn't know I was lost. I didn't know I was in darkness until the scripture pointed out, hey, you're lost in your sin. So you have to acknowledge, number one, that there is a God. Two, that you're lost in your sin. Three, that Jesus came to die for your sin, so you accept him as your Savior. And you call out to the Lord. The scripture says you believe with your heart, you profess with your mouth, and you believe, you will be saved. So you can pray that. Say, Lord, forgive me for my sins. Come into my heart. He will come and live in your heart. And then you can have a relationship with him and begin walking with him. So he's already come to this planet almost 2,000 years ago. He made his triumphal entry. And you too can accept him, because he is the Lamb of God. So with that, I hope you guys have a blessed Palm Sunday. Hopefully we can gather soon. And please, I can leave the comments open on YouTube. You need prayer for anything, just please let us know. But pray that we can gather again, and we hope to see you soon. God bless you.